हेलो मिस्टर निनन,
हेलो
वेलकम टू आर सीरीज द ट्रांसफॉर्मर सीरीज सीजन टू। मिस्टर निनन, यू हैव बीन अ बैंकर फॉर ओवर 3 decades एंड देन यू मूव टू द फाउंडेशन अबाउट 3 years बैक। व्हाट वाज द इंस्पिरेशन और मोटिवेशन ऑफ दिस चेंज?
वेल, आई कंसिडर द वर्क दैट वी डू एट द फाउंडेशन ऑलमोस्ट इक्वलेंट टू व्हाट वी डू इन एनी कॉर्पोरेट फंक्शन। एज लॉन्ग एज यू हैव अ स्ट्रेटजी, यू हैव अ गोल टू अचीव and you have a execution strategy in place, to me it is same as anything else. Having been on the corporate side for close to 3 decades, this was a new testing ground for me. So when an opportunity came in, I latched on to it to do basically, personally, it's for doing something different. Personally, to discover a part of India that I was not exposed to, because we are working in the area of rural livelihoods. So to connect with people across India in various states was perhaps a trigger. And also I have had a conviction that CSR or corporate philanthropy, as I would like to call it, was fully entrenched in the organization. So that was an interesting piece when I decided to take that plunge.
And what has been the experience over the last 3 years? What are some of your hurrah moments?
There have been hurrah moments or two, because coming from a banking stable, we decide to create numbers because we feel that a goal, a number is important to pep up the team, to pep up the work. So when we successfully completed our work with 1 million rural households, and when some of the studies revealed that significant part of the objectives have been met, with sustainability as an element deeply entrenched in those work, it was actually a hurrah moment for us. Working with governments, we have had many successful moments with the government. Generally, it is said that working with government slows you down, but our experience has been different, because we believe that government is the biggest development agency. You can't stay away from government and do the work that we are trying to do. So working with the government has been a prime focus for us. Challenges, again, it comes from the government, because the way government functions, you have to align to it. The biggest success for us is the partnerships that we have been able to develop. We don't do the implementation on our own. We co-create, each of these projects are co-created by well-meaning, along with well-meaning NGO partners. We onboard a partner after a great deal of thought. It's not just ticking boxes, it's an emotional connect that we establish with them. So their ground presence is very important to us. So that has been, building those 15 or 16 core partnerships has been the biggest hurrah moment for us, because I can clearly say that the biggest capability in us is our partners. So we don't want to replicate what they have already achieved, or what core competency they have developed for themselves. Instead of that, we join them, but our program team then co-creates the work with them, and then have decided to invest in them long term. We don't believe in short term methods. We are one organization which feels that we have to invest long term in this development journey.
There is a lot of conversation these days that the triumvirate of the corporate sector and the state and the civil society and NGOs needs to come together to do transformative work and address some of the development goals that we face.
Yes, surely, because in the last 3 years we have had major successes with government collaborations together with our NGO partners. It is working well, because if we are in the area that we are working, which is rural livelihoods, we can't work in pilots forever. we have to work in scale, and scale can be achieved only if we work along with government. 10 foundations like us, even if we come with all our money, it's not sufficient. The 6 lakh villages in India, which require some kind of transformation, economic and social transformation, for that we have to necessarily work with government, and work government is ready to put their hand forward, and once you shake hands, the scale is possible. So if you take any example, whether it is the village social transformation mission in Maharashtra, or our partnership with the Assam State Rural Livelihood Mission, or the Chhattisgarh Mega Watershed Program, these are all strong collaborations with the government. So I think it's important that each of the stakeholders acknowledge and accept the other's role in that.
So the other question that comes up in a lot of discussions is that on one hand we are pursuing our GDP goals of being a 5 trillion economy, and on the other hand we also have certain commitments to the development goals, as you mentioned, at 2030. Do you see these two kind of playing together? Do you see an inherent conflict in it? How do you see these two goals?
I would not say a conflict, but to answer your question directly, it's yes and no. While we may grow our GDP, it's of no good to achieve the sustainable development goals if the vast gap that exists between people at the bottom of the pyramid and people above, it's ever increasing, and that's the biggest development challenge that we are facing in India. So the objective should be to grow GDP, and there's no reason why we should not be a $5 trillion economy, but then compressing that gap that exists. So for that it is necessary that people, the underserved communities, are mainstreamed further, instead of only the top growing and taking us to a $5 trillion economy. It will be a dream come true if everybody is a part of this transformation. That is our dream. That is our dream. Then that's why we have chosen this area of rural livelihoods, because rural is where the development has not happened as it should be.
So Ninan, you moved into the development work about after 3 decades of banking career. Do you see a role of more professionals? Do you see a role and a need for more professionals like you coming into this sector and contributing meaningfully, and maybe even at a mid-level, mid-career level stage? And so what would be your sense of if they?
The professionals coming into this area will surely bring some smartness into this whole objective. For a moment, I don't mean that the NGO space is less smart. They are smart in their own way, but to make it more result-oriented, to make it more efficient and have a larger accountability, it is important that there is some corporate infusion into this journey. That doesn't make the role of a true development professional any less. They surely have the first place in this, but then it has to be a consortium of efforts there. It's a happy moment for India when we see a lot of people today trying to come into the space, living their career midway, and then trying to do something of substance here. Many people are taking this up as a career too. But then when corporate person comes here, it should not be just to write a check. It should be to bring his knowledge and capability at the ground level, grassroots level execution. So for that, some of the corporate capabilities, if it rubs off here, why not?
Okay. And what is it that kind of your feel of how the development work has moved over the last 10, 15 years? Though you've been engaged with it only recently, but do you see some of those challenges becoming more manageable? Do you see that we've created more challenges and issues for us than we have solved them? What's your sense on that?
No, I don't think we have created more challenges, but we have consciously made it tougher for us in terms of accountability and monitoring and evaluation. Unless it is outcome based, I don't think any development intervention is worth it. So if you are not able to cast the outcomes, measure it on a daily basis, on a quarterly basis, with the baselines and end lines and the whole process, that doesn't mean that you have to invest your whole energy into that. But by doing it smartly, you do a business, you measure yourself quarterly, isn't it? You are accountable to the board on a quarterly basis. So this also has to be in that manner. Unless it is done in that manner, it will not be sustainable. It will not be possible for you to achieve the end objective. So measurement is, so some of this yardstick that has been brought out, some of the processes that has been brought in place, the governance that has been ensured in many of the civil society organizations that was not there in the past, is enabling a lot of trust to be created. So the partners that we work with are all well governed, with a diversified board, with clear accountability. So that enables us to place our trust in them. Then it is a question of only getting into the brass tacks of implementation. Earlier that was not the case. Earlier it was just trusting the main person, okay, his intentions are good, so let us give. Now it is more about the process, it's become more process oriented. If you may ask me one single term for it, it has become more process oriented, like any corporate function.
Thank you very much for giving us the time. It's been a real pleasure. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you.